My name is Emiliano Firmino. I am a software developer from Brazil. And I will present here one extension that we have developed that brings to Erlang support for object-oriented programming. We have created a very thin extension, so you can continue to program in Erlang, but using this extension, you can use in objects, just like you can do in C++, Java, and other object-oriented programming languages. So, okay, now who I am? Well, now I'm the current maintainer of Erlang. It's an extension of Erlang. And I work as a software developer at INDT. INDT is a company in Brazil that helps Microsoft to develop applications and research related to mobile phones. And also, I am a master's student at the University of Pernambuco, Federal University of Pernambuco. And I have a degree in computer engineering by the State University of Amazonas. The Erlang is the only programming functional programming language that I have some experience. I have tried before F-sharp, Haskell, but I didn't dedicate enough time. So I only Erlang that I have some experience. And in my daily basis, I work with C++ and C#. But I have some experience with Java and JavaScript. Because of this project, I have some experience with programming languages, distributed systems. And because my company works with mobile phones, I have some experience with Android and Windows Phone platforms. And multimedia, mainly in audio and video streaming. But where are I from? Well, I'm from Manaus. Manaus is a city in the heart of the Amazon jungle. There are many industries there because the incentives of Brazil government. So there are Honda, Panasonic, Microsoft, and many other companies that produce electronics. But since last year, I live in Recife. Recife is a city that has a strong IT industry. Well, how I get there? I got there. Well, those two cities are apart by just 1,800 miles. So if I want to see my parents, I have to take a plane of 6 hours. But how I got there? Well, 10 years ago, my previous university, my current university, have created a partnership to improve the formation of their professors, because in my state, the university is very young. It has less than 15 years. So they create a partnership, an inter-university doctoral program that helped to create more PhDs and masters in the area. And one of these projects of this program was this one, ooErlang. That was a PhD test for my former supervisor. I'm not the only one that had worked in this project. We have helped from two supervisors from FPE. One of them is my current supervisor, Professor Rafael Lins, and the other, Professor Francisco Jr., one PhD student at the time, that was my former supervisor, Professor Jusmar Jr., and three undergraduate students. That was me and two friends, Daniel Aquino and Rodrigo Bernardino. In this presentation, first I will talk a little background, why we think that it was important to bring object-oriented programming to Erlang, our approach, how we implemented the language, a short crash course here showing how to get the source, install, create a basic class, inheritance, interface, using the language, and comparing with Java and C++. I will talk a little about the internals of the language, how we implemented the objects and translated from our metaprogramming language, or Erlang to Erlang. a short citation about some previous work that we have done with the language and some ideas that we have for future work. And when we finish this presentation, I can answer some questions. Well, that might be a shocking fact, but OOP is very popular. All of you have some knowledge or experience with OOP, object-oriented programming. And we can see this by looking some ranks. If you see that Taiobi rank from this month, we see that the top 10 languages, only one that not supports oriented object programming, that is C. The Java, C++, Object-C, C#, and all these languages have some kind of support to object-oriented programming. Using other rank, Redmonk rank, the top 10, only two doesn't support object-oriented programming. That is C and CSS. But CSS is not my programming language. And another one, PyPL, the top 10. Only C that doesn't support OOP. So most programmers have some experience with object-oriented programming. They work with some popular languages like C++, Java, Python, Ruby. And so they have some experience, with exception of C. But C, you have the option to use C++ or Objective-C to have support to object-oriented programming. And OOP is widely used in the industry. So many APIs that are provided for the vendors are created for to access object-oriented programming. Some kind of object-oriented organization. And is part of many curriculums of computer science and computer engineering undergraduate course. That's not a while functional programming language is still not widely adopted. But these have some flaws. One mainly flaw that I can see here, it is the reason why functional programs have returned to popularity, is because of multi-core processors. Since our process could get more faster by just speed up the frequency, the industry have changed from a monocore architecture, monocore processor, to an architecture based on many cores. So now we have our machine, our phones, have four cores, 8 cores, 16 cores, and God knows how many cores in the future. So multi-core programming is very hard compared to traditional traditional serial languages. And the communication between the process is hard. And in many OOP languages, it's very error prone. So it's very easy to make some mistake in writing some parallel code or concurrent code in Java, C++, that would be in Haskell or Erlang. But not in Erlang. Erlang has some nice premises that can help you to implement, to extract all the processing power of this new architecture. In Erlang, everything is a process. So the language itself has native support to creation, destruction, and communication of process. Processes are cheap to create. You can easily spawn one process in Erlang. You just have to know one function, the function name, for example. Process share nothing, so there's no risk from a race condition or some kind of interaction between many threads that corrupt your data. And the communication is always explicit. If you want to send a message to a process, there is an explicit operator in the language that helps you to send a message. But how much cheap is the creator of this process? Running a simple code that just create a thread, a power thread, and measure how much time it takes to create a thread and join it. I could measure how much time it takes to create a process. For example, in Java, it takes 200 200 microseconds, while Cthread 50 microseconds using pthreads, while in Erlang just 15 microseconds. And in Erlang, processes are managed by the virtual machine. So it's not the operating system that should handle this. And they are much more lax memory expensive when they create it. But Erlang is not very popular. In Taiyobi index, its number is 36. And the last measurements, they have declined. And Erlang uses a Prolog-like syntax. For many people, it's not very, not very familiar when you come from the language that are more C-like. And it's not very well known in the OOP community. So what do you have think? What have you thought? How we can help that we have so many developers that have spent many time studying, programming, have large knowledge of OOP programming to start using Erlang? How we can help to lower the bar to they start using the language? So we thought, why we don't help them to apply the knowledge and tools from OOP in Erlang by adding support to OOP in the language? They can still use models in Erlang, all the features of the Erlang, but now there's an option that they can use object-oriented programming in the language. And that's why that's our approach. We have created an extension for the language. This is the site of the language. It's a little, had some time that we didn't update it. But the purpose of this is that we have an extension for the language that provides object-oriented programming with a syntax that will be more familiar for Java programmers. Our approach is a lightweight extension that's very thin over Erlang. It should be fully backward compatible with the language, but using this extension, you can create objects. You can use inheritance. You can use interface and use a design patterns for object-oriented programming and many other features that have been developed for OOP. To do that, we have to support three pillars that any OOP language must support. That is abstract data types, that's just class. In object-oriented programming, class objects are just a bunch of data and methods that operate together. Inheritance, that we can declare an object, declare a class, and define a more specialized one that provides some nice new features and can enable reuse of code of the parent, for example. And dynamic call, when we have in a static type language where you have a car, if you use a specialized type of car, when you call a function of a car, they have to solve to the specialized one, not the parent one. So you have to know when running that this object is not the parent, but the children. The first step to start using our extension is get the code. The code is available at GitHub, at github.com/ooErlang. And it's very simple to start using it. Okay. You just have to clone the repository and make it. I can show here. After you clone the repository, you have our source code. It's just Erlang code. And you can make this code using just make. It will generate a bin folder with our file is compiled. And the next step you have to do is to create an environment variable that will be used by the tools, the compiler, and the helper that we use to execute a program. called ooErlang. And if you add this path, if you add this environment variable to the path, you can easily compile and run some ooErlang code. There are two tools that we basically use to compile and execute object Erlang code. That is our compiler, OOEC, that receives one or more source files. We use an extension .cerl, that means class Erlang. And just like in C and Java, if you declare a static main function, you can easily run your program using the OOE program, run command line. So I can show here basic hello world, so you can get the feeling about the language. Basically, we define a hello.crl. You can see? Oh, I should. Okay. Basically, we have a class declared in Erlang that is called hello. And we define a class method that adjusts some methods that are associated with the class, not the object. Just like a static type, static. Here we are using IO format to just print a message. We can compile this code using hello.crl. It's compiled and you can run using hello. What we does here when we call always the compiler, we create an equivalent of this code in Erlang. This creates an object we are not using here. And it's mapped this defined function to a default. Just map this class method function to a Erlang function. Okay. So now how we define a class? A class is just a bunch of data and methods associated. Here we have a class called person that have a first name, last name, and age. We have a constructor called new that receives the first name, last name, and age. And a method called print that print this data in a stdout. If we would do this in Java, you would have something like this. We can break this declaration in three parts. The first one is there are some definition. We are saying here that this is a class. We are defining a class called person. And we can have, for example, the package that this class are from, or which classes we are using. We have some dependency. The second part is the attributes. Here we have first name, last name, and age. And finally, we have some methods. We have the constructor and a print method. If we would describe this function using C++, they follow the same idea. We have three parts. The first one, we have some definition. Here we are defined as the class. And it depends of IO string and string. We have some attributes. And finally, we have some methods. In ooErlang, it's the same thing. Use a slight different syntax than we use just Erlang. But we follow the same structure. We have some definition here. Here we are defining a class that have a constructor called new that receives three params and export print. The second part, we have some attributes. Because Erlang is not a statically typed language, we don't have to define the type. Here, we could optionally initialize these values. And finally, we have some methods. We have a constructor and a print. I can execute the same code that I show you here. First, the Java. Just the same thing that was defined there. The only difference that we have here is static main point, an entry point. So we can run this code in show. It's running. Show the result here. We have the same code for C++. The same code that I show in the slide. The only difference here is that we have entry point. And we can compile using C++. And finally, we can do the same thing for our class in ooErlang. The same class. The only difference here that we have entry point, just like in Java and C++. Okay. The second pillar of object-oriented programming, inheritance. We are a simple inheritance. We have a car that's a parent class, and that child that is a hybrid car. In the parent car, we have some methods. We can start the car engine. We can stop the car engine, and we can honk. And the hybrid car, he changes the implementation of start and stop, but he uses the honk implementation from this parent class. If you will declare this in Java, it would be something like this. In Java, car is just a trivial class, but in the child one, we have to use a special notation. We have to say that's hybrid car extends car. And we implemented this method, the method start and stop. And optionally, we can call the parent using super.start or super.stop to reuse some code from the parent class. In C++, it would be something like this. Because C++ is a little different, in the parent class, you have to say that these methods can be override. So you have to declare that these methods are virtual. And in the child class, you say that the public car, the hybrid car, extend public car, use this notation. And when you want to call a parent method, you have to explicitly say the name of the parent. For example, here, car. In ooErlang, we follow something similar to Java. So you don't have to change anything in your parent class. But in the child class, you have to say that this class extends for the parent. In this case, it's hybrid car, extend from car. And we can explicitly call a method from the parent using super, just like in C++ in Java. Can show here. Oops. We have a car and a hybrid car. It's just a trivial class. And hybrid car. And we have here our main class that just our wrapper for our main function. What this main does is it creates a car and creates a hybrid car, C1 and C2. We call the C1 and C2 both are defined as car. We first call start from C1, honk from C1, and stop from C1. And following, we do the same thing for car 2. Start, honk, and stop. Honk is not defined in the hybrid car, but because hybrid car inherits from car, they can reuse this of the parent code. Can compile here and run. So here we have that car 1 have started the main engine, honk, and stop the main engine. While car 2, that is a specialized type of car, first we have to initialize the electric engine. And after that, we call the parent method, main engine, using super. Car 2 have not defined a honk, but because its inheritance from car, they have this method. And after that, we stop the main engine and stop the electric engine. In C++, we have some very similar. C++. We do the same thing here that we does in the Java main. We create a car, create a hybrid car, and we call start, honk, and stop. The same thing we do for car 2. C++. D equals C++ 11. So here you get the same output that we saw in Java. Honk is not defined in car 2, so they reuse the implementation from car 1. And we do the same thing here in our example using ooErlang. We have not defined honk here, but it will reuse the parent class. So OEC. There are some ones because I'm not using, but it's not important here. And we can call main. But just before that, this, I can show you our main. Basically, it does the same thing that we did in Java and C++. We create a car and call the methods start, honk, and stop. And we have the same output. So we have now the last example. We have interface that's a special kind of inheritance where in the interface we don't define have no implementation in the interface, just a contract that the shard class must implement. So here we have a shape that implements a method called calculateArea. And because square, circle, and triangle implement this method, they must implement the calculateArea. In Java, there is a special kind of keyword that you say to the compiler. You say public interface shape. So all the methods in the interface must be abstract. They have no implementation. In C++, we don't have an interface keyword, but you can get the same behavior by creating a pure abstracted class where all the methods are virtual and not are virtual and not have an implementation. We follow the same syntax, same idea here in ooErlang. We say that we replace class by interface. So shape is a type of interface that supports the method calculate area. One moment, please. And this method don't have implementation. When we implement this in Java, we say that, for example, square. Square implements shape. Use this syntax. And because of that, they must implement the method calculate area. C++ follow the same syntax that we saw for inheritance. But if you don't implement calculate area, there will be a compiler error. And in ooErlang, we follow the same syntax from Java. We have additional definition that we say class square implements shape or one or more interfaces. Can see here our classes. We can compile JavaScript. And the method run, method main, just an entry point. Here we define a shape, three shapes, a shape circle, shape square, and shape triangle. With circle, we create a circle, create a square, and a triangle. And because all of these objects are shapes, we can call calculate area. Here we can run Java main. So we have the area for each of these objects. We can do the same thing for C++. Oops. We have a main function, a main entry point, that does the same thing that we did in Java. We have three kinds of shape, a circle, square, and triangle. And we access this method calculate area. You get the same results. And in object-oriented Erlang, it's the same thing. We have our classes here. We have a main entry point that does the same thing that we did in Java and C++. We create a circle. We create a square. We create a triangle. And we invoke the method calculate error for each one. So we get the same behavior that we saw in Java and C++. But how we implement the language? Now we'll talk about how internally we map object Erlang to Erlang. Basically, we map with objects, our dictionary process. When you create an object, they map to Erlang in a tuple that have the class name and instance name. I can show here, use the same code that we just executed. I can use the Erlang terminal. I can here create a circle, new, 5. So in Erlang, object are mapped to a tuple that the first element is the class name, and the second one is a process. We use this process to simulate the behavior of an object that can change states. When you change the state of an object, we send this information for this process. One moment. So objects are just a tuple that have a class and an instance. This class is just an atom that is the model of this object. And instance is a process ID that maps all the attributes that we define to entries in a process dictionary, and process map those attributes to our entries in the proxy dictionary. And when we call a method from an object that follows the syntax object double colon method, we translate this to class called function with instance as just the first parameter. I can show here. We have implemented in the circle the method calculate area. So we can, for example, first we have a class and an instance of circle. We have stacked this. We have the class adjust item and instance is a process ID. And we can call class calculate area instance to get the same result that we saw in the command line. Okay. But because we are creating process, there are some problems that we have solved in the future. We say more about that. Okay. So what our compiler does, we have some steps to implement this behavior. Our compiler translates or Erlang in 7 steps. First, the first step, I can demonstrate this using the compiler. OEC have some additional options that you can say that you want to get the tokens, the AST, abstract syntax tree. So the first, our compiler, he reads the file, he extracts the tokens, they pass the tokens to create abstract syntax tree. We translate this abstract syntax tree from ooErlang to Erlang. After that, we format the code, write to a file, and compile using Erlang. So I can show some tokens here, use the, for example, I can open this shape. I can say, OOC, get me the tokens of this this class, this interface. And when you probably pass this command, OOC token shape, he prints all the tokens that compose that file. And after that, we can go to the next phase, that is pass the to create the abstract syntax tree that represents that data. OAST shape.circle or circle or square. And with this abstract syntax tree, we can translate this, we can analyze, we can identify where are defined those objects, and convert from Erlang, from ooErlang to Erlang. I could show here using AST, but that is a bug. So it's crashing. I have to solve this later. And I can show here the result from the compilation. For square don't count because the interface don't generate code, but I can see, for example, a square. Oops. Square. He maps square, that's a class, to a model in Erlang. And this model implement the method calculate area. Here, calculate area receives the object ID that I showed you, that's just an instance, and communicate it with the dictionary object to get the values. And because we have the code in Erlang, we can just compile using Erlang. Our compiler organizing some models. I will say I will brief tell about each one. We have a AST that basically manipulates the syntax tree. We have a core that is a compiler main engine. We have used this library called OOE. You have seen here that we use this in runtime to communicate with the dictionary object. And initially, we are using a modified version of the parser from Erlang, but they have some issues because they don't support macros, definition, defines. So now we are using a modified version of Aleppo. Aleppo is a syntax analyzer that for Erlang that can handle the loading of headers. If you include a header in your Erlang file, the Aleppo parser will support. You can use macros and other features that are not available in the OOE parser. And there are some other models, like OOE scan, that we are using to extract these tokens. At runtime, there are two main APIs. We have OOE, that's have saw you. OOE compiler. We can compile the same code that I show you here using this API. For example, one moment. I forgot the name of the classes. You can say here OOC compile shape square, for example, and we will compile the square function, the square. And there is this OOEUtils that you can get the tokens in the abstract stack tree for Erlang and ooErlang. And we use the language to implement the 23 parsers from Gang of Four. These are available at our site, our repository. And we have used it to implement a benchmark. We have implemented Intel MPI benchmark to compare Java, Scala, Erlang, ooErlang, Python, and Ruby in the communicate intensive patterns, message patterns that's defined in this MPI. This is available too in our repository. And finally, there are many things to do yet. We have to provide a better integrated development environment using, for example, Eclipse or other environment. I have said before, we are creating dictionaries to keep the object states. We have to implement some kind of garbage collector. So when all the reference for these objects are gone, we can destroy these objects. Now we have to explicitly call a method, some kind of standard object library that will provide some additional functionalities that are provided by the Erlang, but based on objects, some kind of interactive terminal, so you can use the syntax to create, destroy, and call methods from an object without the need to translate the call conventions from Erlang to Erlang. And there are some bug fixes to do. Okay? Thank you very much.